in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
This is the October 15th, 2018 meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and all five commissioners are present tonight. So we will begin with Commissioner Boswell. If you would do the invocation and lead us in the pledge, please.
I will. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, thank you for all your blessings you have given us. And God, just be with all the folks that have been in the path of these storms and the gentlemen that are out tonight working, trying to get power back, cutting trees, just protect them. And Lord, just help us as commissioners to do what's right for Alamance County and make decisions that are good for our citizens. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
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 I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, our first order of business tonight is that we wanted to take some time first to recognize some businesses and churches that helped out with our shelters, with donations during the Hurricane Florence that we had a couple weeks ago. And so, Michelle, our public information officer, how should we do this? Do you want me to come down, or Tori, should we come down and hand them out and take pictures like that? Okay, we'll do that. So we sure do appreciate all of you folks. Alamance County is a wonderful community of giving people who look out for each other, and so many of these organizations, these churches, they just did this out of due to their hearts, not expecting to get anything, but we would like for the citizens to know how much we appreciate them, or how much we appreciate these people who helped out, and to be able to know and to recognize that. So I've got some certificates. I'll call out these names, and I don't know if there are people in the overflow room. We might run and check. The first one is for Lamb's Chapel Church. Is there anybody from Lamb's Chapel here?
He said that he appreciated the gesture, but they wouldn't be able to make it. Sure. Thank you.
Okay, so they weren't able to come tonight. But Lamb's Chapel, among other things, I'm sure they did. They hosted one of the shelters for a period of time, so that was really amazing. We have a certificate for Walmart. All three, Burlington, Graham, and Mebane locations. Is there anybody here from Walmart? Well, the Walmart people are coming. How about the Mebane Church of Christ? Is there anybody from the Mebane Church of Christ here? And Southbound Sandwich Works.
She also said that she wasn't able to make it, but they just appreciated the opportunity to help. It was just out of the goodness of their heart.
Awesome.
They didn't need any public recognition.
They provided some of the food for some of the people. How about the City of Graham? Is there anybody here from the City of Graham? And the City of Burlington? The Times News? Would you be representing the Times News tonight?
He's a good one.
No, I was told not to.
Lowe's Home Improvement.
Johnny Payne's going to deliver there.
He's out of town, helping down east.
Okay, of course. Helping out. Smithfield's. I guess that's a barbecue place. Helped out with some food. Western Charcoal Steakhouse. Wonderful. Thank you so much. Here you go. You want to take a picture for Mr. Bartosz, you want to take one with Scott over here? Thank you. All right. Do we find anybody of those people in the... what about K&W Cafeteria? You made them there. And Golden Corral. Well, we do appreciate, we know people are busy and have a lot going on, and they didn't do it because they wanted to get thanked. But we do thank them and appreciate that very much. Now, we also have some young people to recognize tonight from the, and I'm just going to stand here and read it instead of walking around and coming back, from the Alamance County Rescue Unit Junior Program. We have three young people who participated in that tonight and got some awards. So let me tell you what they did. The Alamance County Junior Rescue Junior Program is designed to take young adults in the community and instill the fundamentals of rescue operations, stimulate interest in rescue emergency medical service field, provide opportunities to be involved in rescue services, and learn the history of rescue emergency medical services. Participants in this program work alongside with members of the unit, gaining knowledge for the future and building a lifelong bond. Over the course of time, junior members develop skills in the use of rescue equipment, vehicle extrication, ropes, first aid, and much more. Many opportunities are given, such as gaining experience by running calls with members, earning certifications, and going to compete each year to show the knowledge learned to carry out a scenario. On September 8, 2018, three juniors had the chance to compete in the 2018 North Carolina Association of Rescue and EMS Convention. Juniors who competed as a team were Daniel Brooks, Caitlin Lloyd, and Landon Flood. These juniors were tasked with a scenario that consisted of rigging a basket for a vertical lower that included a main line, belay line, internal, external lashing, tag line, and a 3-to-1 mechanical advantage haul system in belay system. I don't know what any of that means. But that sounds really impressive. Did I say it right? Belay. Before starting the actual scenario, the juniors had to show their knowledge and skills of tying knots in the technical rescue standards. Upon completing the knots portion, Daniel and Caitlin packaged the patient in the basket using internal and external lashing. Caitlin was then swapped out with Landon, where along with Daniel moved on to the 3-to-1 mechanical advantage system. The mechanical advantage system had to be set up beyond a black line that acted as a rooftop where the rest of the scenario would take place on the roof of a building. After setting up the system, the juniors had to pull the system and then reset at least one time before the basket was past the black line. After resetting the system twice, the team successfully pulled the basket past the line, completing the scenario. So, y'all did awesome. For achievement for first place finish in the 2018 North Carolina Association of Rescue and EMS Technical Rescue Competition. So that is so awesome. Okay, so Daniel Brooke and Caitlin. And Caitlin Lloyd. Good job, Caitlin. And Landon Flood. So good job, Landon.
I'm thankful that I'm in the unit, the people that I spend time with, it's like a family for me. I know if I need anything, they're there for me, along with people I've met in the county with EMS and other fire services. It's a bond that you really can't describe, and I'm thankful for all of them.
Anybody else? Y'all got parents here?
Yes.
Anybody and parents want to stand up?
May I ask, where do you go to school?
I go to Southern.
Southern?
I'm at ACC.
Western Alice High School.
Great.
Question. That almost sounds exciting.
It sure does. Okay.
Awesome. agenda is public speakers. And as some of our guests take their leave, let me, before we go into the public speakers, let me just address the public comment policy of the Board of Commissioners and a little bit about the decorum. As expected, this public comment policy was adopted as revised in September of 2014. The comment period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. Then there's a commissioner's response period immediately following the public comment period. This should be a point of response from commissioners to respond to comments that have been made, not debates with the public. And the purpose of a public comment period is not to create a town hall kind of atmosphere. This is a board of government that is meeting. It's not a committee discussion kind of thing. Each person desiring to speak during the public comment period shall have 3 minutes to make his or her remarks. There should be no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting, and that would be 3 persons pro the topic and 3 persons who might be opposed to the topic. And I'm going to hold folks, so we have 6 people signed up for public comments, so I'm going to hold you to 3 minutes. And that's nothing personal against anybody who's speaking. It's kind of like the shot clock in college basketball. When the shot clock goes off, the referee takes the ball and gives it to the other team. So that's just the rule. Speakers shall please address the board from the lectern at the front of the room and begin their remarks by stating their name and address. Speakers should be courteous in the language and presentation, and so on and so forth. So if anybody's watching this on video and you're thinking about coming to make a public comment, if you could review that policy before you come, that would probably be a good use of your time. And then we also have the rules of procedure for the Board of Commissioners that were adopted, I believe, in January 2017. And it has a section in here about the decorum of the audience. And that's Article 6, Section 7. In order to efficiently transact public business, it's necessary that members of the audience demonstrate an appropriate decorum and respect for the board and speakers. So audience members refrain from making unsolicited comments. During speakers from the floor or debate by the board, audience members refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceedings. And then there's other stuff. If you could review that, if you're thinking about coming to a meeting, that would be useful. So, with that being said, the first person that we have on our public comment sign-up sheet is Charlie Deaton.
Thank you. My name is Charlie Deaton. Address is 4122 Belmont, Mount Hermon Road, Burlington. And the reason, and I appreciate you letting me come to visit with you tonight, I'm here tonight because to express a concern that I am beginning to see in Alamance County, and for a better term, it's the junkification of Alamance County. We're beginning on Belmont Mount Hermon Road. There are 4 residents where it's absolutely ridiculous of what we're beginning to see as far as junk in the yard, not mowing the yard. My next door neighbor house burned over a year ago. It's been abandoned. He's not taking care of the property. He's not keeping anything picked up. He's not mowing the yard. And I want to know why that this body, this government body, is not doing something to protect the largest asset that we have in the county, and that is our property.
I agree with you.
I would like to think that we would have at least some standards, whether it be just from a standpoint of keeping a yard mowed and maintained, being respectful for the neighbors in the community who do have a respect for the largest, I guess you might say, the largest investment that they have. They take care of it, they keep it clean, they keep it neat. But it's getting to a point now, and I guess it's because we have no zoning in Alamance County, that people just do what they want to do, and it's the few that is destroying our property values of the majority of people. And I just want to know why this is allowed to happen in our county. That's all I have to say.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Deaton. We'll have an opportunity to comment at the end of the all the people who signed up. So I'm sorry, I don't know how I'll pronounce this last name. Gary Ulicny. I'm sorry.
Ulicny.
I have a couple handouts. Can I give those to you?
Yes, sure, please.
Okay, one is a copy of my comments. I know I have to speak quickly. My name is Gary, Dr. Gary Ulichny. I'm a permanent resident of Snow Camp. I live at 845 Soapstone Trail in Snow Camp, North Carolina. I want to thank you for the opportunity to address you. I'm here representing a number of concerned residents. I think we have some in here. Anybody who is here from Snow Camp? And there's over 40 in the overflow room that are also here. First, let me say, and we're here to talk about a proposal by Alamance Aggregate, a company registered in Sheridan, Wyoming, to locate a 300-plus acre gravel pit mine in Snow Camp. First, let me say we were shocked that we had to learn about this project, which could dramatically change our quality of life through a flyer placed on a local convenience store by a concerned citizen. Even more funny, I think we learned about it before a lot of you guys did. We're even more shocked to learn the county had approved the application without any public notification, input, or comment. We understand the process for this application is covered by the Alamance County Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance, which requires the company to submit an application. The criteria to the planning department. The criteria mainly focuses on screening buffers, lighting, fencing, parking. It does talk about stream buffers and floodplains, but I could not find any specific measurements in the ordinance online. There are currently several ponds and creeks on the proposed site, and the property has a FEMA floodplain on the property and abuts another FEMA floodplain. The most disturbing part of the ordinance, there's no requirement for this application to be reviewed by the planning board, whose mission states our responsibility is to oversee land development, code enforcement, historic property issues, and community activities in the unincorporated portions of our county. Finally, there's no final approval requirement from the commissioners, meaning that this decision was made for such an intrusive and expansive project by staff alone with no oversight or community involvement. Despite what Alamance Aggregate says, this type of mine can have significant impacts on the community. That is recognized in the heavy industrial ordinance where it says, whereas industrial land uses by their very nature may produce objectionable secondary effects, including aesthetic impact, traffic, noise, odors, vibrations, fumes, etc. And none of these impacts mentioned stop at property lines. There's no fence. Many studies have recognized the impacts of these projects. They include soil erosion, dust, especially crystalline silica, which is classified as a human lung carcinogen. Breathing this has been shown to cause a great number of things, including tuberculosis. The particles are carried airborne and can be carried miles from both by the wind and trucks. And I'd like to remind the commissioners that this site is just a little over a mile from Sylvan Elementary School and almost adjacent to a church. Certainly noise, you can't crush stone, truck it, or blast without noise. That can't be my time.
3 minutes.
That's it?
I feel your pain.
All right, one last thing then. I have a whole bunch of things in here that talk about property values and a variety of other things. But we are here tonight, though, because we are concerned that the county has not done its fiduciary responsibility in significantly analyzing the impact of this. And on behalf of the affected citizens of the project, we are formally appealing the approval of this project, calling for a postponement of the approval of the project and the referral of this project to the Alamance County Planning Board, who were appointed to protect the rights of unincorporated citizens.
Thank you, Dr. Ulichny.
And also to contact the state and rescind approval of the permit until the input analysis is complete. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. The next on our list is Tracy Nestor.
Can I mention just one quick thing?
No, sir. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, sir.
This is so important. I understand.
I'm sorry. Your time is up.
There is a gas pipeline that runs through this as well, of which they carry jet fuel, kerosene, and gasoline. Okay, I just wanted to make sure. There's a map attached that shows you where that pipeline runs.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Okay. She has a handout she's going to give everybody. Mr. Krasinko, we have you down as another separate speaker. So
we can actually tag team if you want.
So
since we're probably going to be around 4 minutes, so I'm going to let him start, and then if I need to wrap it up, then I will.
That's not how we usually do it. We usually don't let people pool their time. We're like, a person speaks for 3 minutes, and then a person speaks for 3 minutes.
I can
so
get through three.
If you want to go out of order, and Mr. Kosinko, you go first. That's
okay.
Fine.
I appreciate that. Madam Chair, members of the board, Tony Kosinko, Municipal Manager with Republic Services, 2140 Bishop Road, Greensboro. Thank you for the opportunity to serve Alamance County residents for 22-plus years, and we wish to continue serving your constituents, our customers. We started here with Bo Barber back in 1996. We acknowledge we've had recent service challenges during a major reroute that created some collection failures and customers were affected. We apologize, but as a result, routes were right-sized for the efficiency anticipated growth in the area. We did the right thing, and customers are better served as a result. Service is back to a 99.9% reliability. Staff can verify that service calls are now the exception, not the norm. New division management is in place with dramatic results. Republic Services had 22-plus successful years of serving Alamance County residents, and we ask that our full performance be considered, not just the brief period during major re-engineering of routes. Performance matters to Republic and our customers, and for over 22 years, we have delivered. Alamance County has approximately 9,200 trash customers, and only 21% utilize recycling service. To put it simply, the current recommendation creates 100% of Alamance customers, all 9,200, will see an increase in their bill January 1st. Over the five-year term, Alamance residents will pay an additional $1.3 million more for service than necessary. With an award to Republic Services, 79% of Alamance customers, 7,250 customers, will see a decrease in their bill January 1st. Why penalize 79% of residents so 21% can save 5 cents per month to recycle? Additionally, Republic Services owns and operates the recycle facility in Greensboro to ensure recycled material is processed. Republic Services has recycling facilities in Charlotte and Conover that can be utilized through our transfer station should the Greensboro facility go down for repairs. Republic Services offers community education opportunities at our recycling facility in Greensboro for community groups, schools, and government education. Can the other vendor supply the same? Republic currently services Alamance County areas 1 and 2 on Mondays. Will customers be forced to endure another route day change because of a vendor change? Republic Services respectfully requests the commissioners to consider the Republic Services proposal before making an award. As an alternative, Republic Services prepared to continue servicing areas 1 and 2 at the new proposed rates and extend the contract for 1 year so that your constituents can take advantage of the savings. Commissioners and staff can further evaluate Republic's commitment to service. We thank you for the opportunity to present all the relevant facts for your consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Tracy, did you have, Ms. Nestor, did you have anything to say, to add?
My name is Tracy Nestor. I'm the Senior Area Municipal Services Manager with Republic Services. And Madam Chair, Commissioners, and Manager Haygood, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to present this evening. I also want to thank you for the opportunity to serve Alamance County for the past 22 years. I think, as Tony mentioned, we started here in 1996 with Bo Barber. And I have to admit, I've been with Republic for 10 years now. And my first 2 weeks on the job were here in Alamance County with Bo and riding and driving the routes. And I'm very discouraged that the recommendation from staff is based on the service failures that we had in this last year. I ask that council, that the commissioners consider our proposal. Consider the savings to your constituents. The recommendation this evening is going to guarantee that all 9,200 customers will receive a price increase January the 1st. The Republic Services proposal was much different and offered a savings to the customers, to 7,250 customers to be exact. Our reroute, just to give you a little more information about that, was we decided to dedicate trucks to Alamance County on one day. So we have 16 trucks in this county on Mondays. So I anticipate that with moving to another vendor, that those that were impacted by the original reroute will probably be impacted again. Thank you for your consideration. And please let me know if there's any additional information that I can provide you regarding Republic services. Thank you.
Well, this is Thank on you. Our agenda tonight, right?
That's right. That's so an agenda
it will be discussed, so please hang around.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Mr. Eisenhower?
Yes, ma'am. Hopefully I'm not going to repeat anything they said, but it may be similar. But good evening. My name is Drew Eisenhower. I reside at 11 Elm Ridge Lane in Greensboro, North Carolina. I was the area president of our Mid-Atlantic companies, which was 12 states in the Northeast Eastern Shore Board, and recently got promoted to vice president of operations for our entire corporation, and unfortunately live sort of locally to Alamance County. But I met with Commissioner Byrd and Commissioner Gailey 4 months ago almost to this day, and you know, committed to our company that we would improve service. You know, as they mentioned, we've had over 20 years of great service here in Alamance County, and unfortunately we do have to do reroutes occasionally to keep our routes in compliance with DOT hours of service and our own internal safety operation practices. So it was necessary because of the growth in Alamance County. We needed to add additional routes and resources and get our routes right sized to continue giving the great service we are. Unfortunately, you know, to be perfectly honest with you, we screwed up. Just to be blunt. And you know, we made some necessary management changes here locally that oversee the management of this facility. I've got our general manager here tonight. He's not speaking, but I hold these folks accountable to deliver service. I started 30 years ago with this company, driving a truck, picking up people's residential trash, and every customer is as valuable as our largest, and they pay our checks each and every week. So I apologize for the disruption in service. I would hope that you would look at the price. We were charging $16.50 per month for the last 5 years, and we dropped our price to $15. I did that out of good faith for the service issues that we had there for about 6 months. And you know, unfortunately, with the commodity pricing impact with the China sword, you know, recycling rates had to go up. But I would like for you to consider, we do own the local recycling facility right off of 40 in eastern Guilford County. And we can guarantee that your recyclables will be recycled and not disposed of. And if we do have downtime for any reason, we can accommodate and continue the programs through our other two facilities in the area and our additional infrastructure. So I would respectfully request, give us another shot. You know, over the last 4 months, we've gotten back to 99.9% service reliability, as they mentioned. And I can guarantee you my personal reputation will continue doing good service going forward, and I'm localized now, so I can grab a neck if I need to. So thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Eisenhower. Next on the list is Norma Yanez, Y-A-N-E-Z.
Very good, got it right.
Great, and are you here to speak on behalf of Waste Industries?
Yes, ma'am.
Is that right? Okay.
Good evening, Chairman Gailey and other commissioners. My name is Norma Yanez, and I'm the Government Contracts Manager for Waste Industries. Waste Industries has been providing waste and recycling services in North Carolina since 1970. Our corporate office is in Raleigh and has always been in Raleigh, North Carolina. I have worked for Waste Industries for over 28 years. Tonight I do have with me Travis Hitchcock. He's our Regional Vice President. That's Travis over there. Currently, Waste Industries has franchises for waste and recycling for Area 3 for Alamance County. We also provide these services to many other towns in Alamance County, and we also have agreements with other counties, including Brunswick County with 88,000 homes under one contract, Craven with 45,000 homes that we provide recycling services for, Durham, Granville, Martin, and I can name a whole lot more. In our Area 3, currently 22% of our trash customers also have recycle service. Any complaints that we may receive or have received are very minimal. Per your county ordinance, we have an office located in the county, and we deliver all the franchise solid waste to the Alamance County landfill per your franchise agreement. That's a rule per the franchise agreements themselves. Not only do we have an office, we have a fully operational facility located at 703 East Galbraith Street in Graham. We have been in Alamance County over 25 years. I know Alamance County is committed to recycling because you were the first county in the state of North Carolina to ban cardboard. And 25 years ago, or 26, I was here at that time helping businesses convert their cardboard over to recycling. We also employ 20 citizens of Alamance County. When someone from Alamance County calls with a question or concern, they speak to someone sitting in Alamance County. All of our trash customers currently that have carts will have a reduced rate, a 50-cent reduction in rate. I'll just put them verify or straighten out a little statement that was made. Also in Alamance County, we paid $19,000 in county taxes last year. If we're awarded all three franchise areas, we'll purchase brand new trucks. We'll purchase brand new carts. We have budgeted sign-on bonuses and top salaries, four drivers we would need to hire. Any confusion about whose area you were in would be eliminated if we were awarded all three contracts. I would like to thank you for allowing us to participate in this solicitation and would be happy to answer any questions when you get to this agenda item later in the evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming. All right, that closes our public comment, our public speakers, part of our agenda. What commissioner's response?
I'd like to ask, Mr., is it Eisenhower?
Yes, sir.
No, I'm sorry. I meant this gentleman here.
Yes,
I apologize.
Yes, thank you.
Good president, though.
Yeah.
Is it spelled the same way?
No, sir. On the poor side of the family. Thank
okay.
You.
Still good name.
Yes, sir.
What pipeline is it that runs through
it
there?
It is a Colonial Gas pipeline.
Okay.
We talked to Tom West, their representative today. They have heard nothing about this project, had no pre-advance notice. The pipeline carries at any one time or some at the same time kerosene, gasoline, mm-hmm. jet fuel, and I believe diesel fuel.
Well, you got Plantation and Colonial. It goes all the way up to New York.
Correct.
This segment goes toward Raleigh. Is that correct?
Yes, down towards Raleigh.
Mm-hmm.
And, I'm not a genius, but, blasting next to a gas line never mm-hmm. made a whole lot of sense to me.
Mm-hmm.
So
let me ask one more question,
sure.
Or at least another one. Were notices put up around the boundaries of this proposed area?
Please, audience, that is
yes.
a question for the staff or for him.
The state requirement was that anybody who is directly adjacent received a notice, but there were no public notices put up, and some of the people who were directly adjacent are greatly affected. I mean, I live less than a mile from this proposed project. You would think that I'd be notified at least that it was coming, that and have some opportunity for input. That's, one of our
major concerns. I don't think you have to have countywide zoning to put a notice up that this property is being considered for this.
The planning department staff did manage this permit approval
mm-hmm.
Per the ordinance. So the ordinance doesn't require any level of notification, right or wrong. The current existing ordinance doesn't require any of this. So it was managed by the planning staff per the existing ordinance.
So do we have any authority to stop the project? Can we rescind what the planning staff did when they reviewed the project?
I think it could be difficult in that the company has proceeded with purchasing equipment or whatever they've done, because they've been issued an approved permit from Alamance County, which was, I think, issued January the 11th.
It seems like there's so much at risk environmentally.
Really?
I would
property adjacent property owners.
I would wonder. Please don't interrupt. I would wonder if this isn't something we should ask our planning board, since this hasn't been before the planning board. Perhaps as a board of commissioners, we should ask the planning board to take a look at it.
We better talk to Clyde before we do anything.
And yes, and have the involvement of our county attorney.
I can give you an opinion on it.
Okay.
Well, yeah. I'd like for an angle of the inquiry and your decision to be if you had an inept decision made by our planning department, possibly, or director. I mean, I can't believe I'm just hearing about this.
I know. That's
amazing.
I find that it amazing.
It is.
We don't have countywide zoning. Now, what we do have, and I'm not using this to justify the process, of what's taking place, but you do have what's called township zoning. You know, you can zone a township and not the rest of the county, which
correct.
I've always been in support of, but you have to take it upon yourselves to have petitions, if I'm not mistaken, to proceed with that.
If you're going to consider zoning, then I would suggest a unified development ordinance.
Yeah. Well, I'm just
there already is a unified development plan, which lists very clearly that under that heading, the legislature of the state of North Carolina in Part 6, Article of North Carolina statutes delegates to local government units the responsibility, and I've highlighted the word responsibility, to adopt regulations designed to promote the public health, safety, and general welfare of its citizenry. My point is, none of us want to, you know, file litigation or anything because I'm taking money out of one pocket, my taxes, and taking money out of my other pocket. What we want to do is take a step back from this and put into place a reasonable process for evaluating the impacts of this project. And that's basically all we're asking for. And if the company can appeal the denial of the permit, can we not, as citizens, taxpaying citizens of this county, appeal the approval of a permit that's going to have a dramatic effect on our life and our lifestyle?
What you know, they say they're from Wyoming. What do they do in Wyoming? I mean,
I have no idea, but they pay cash.
That's probably where they're registered, right?
And they're a property owner, mm-hmm. and they followed the ordinance, like it or not. It is the ordinance.
Well, the question I would ask you is the legality of that. If you have an ordinance where basically the staff is making that decision without doing the due diligence required, there were no traffic studies, there were no air quality indications, nothing looked at surrounding areas.
I don't know what the staff did. I haven't heard about this before.
I think that that's why this is appropriate to refer to the planning
that's
board.
That's what we're asking.
Right.
I mean, we're asking to, but let us be involved in that process this time. I mean,
right.
we
well,
want to.
Our home.
We.
Sir, please don't interrupt.
And he is right. Property values, and I gave you a study there. I mean,
right.
it could be in the advantage of the county to look at this because in just looking at the adjacent properties, there's $4 million worth of assessed value. If you look at the numbers from the most credible study on this, the average property value loss is 25% to 30%. That represents $1 million in money. That if I'm there and you put this in there, I'm coming to you to reassess my property, and it goes out there to 2 or 3 miles, and it get you know. I think this is not something that just should go across a desk and be signed off. I think this needs some community.
Right. How long have they owned this property?
I don't know when they bought it.
They bought it in pieces and parcels at a variety of time. And
I would suggest to the board that we get the facts and not make a knee-jerk decision.
Yes. Right.
No.
I agree.
And that's why we say, let's go to the Board of Planning, involve people who have been affected by this. Let's sit down and look at the facts. What are the risks? And make an intelligent, informed decision about this, because again, the land development plan says that the planning committee is to balance the interests of the county with the rights and well-being of citizens, and that was failed in this. I mean,
right.
There's no doubt in my mind that failed.
Dr. Olnicki, I think that's
Ulickney.
I'm sorry.
Ulickney.
Ulickney.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
All right.
Ulickney.
Nobody says it right.
I'm sorry. I apologize.
Okay.
People named Gailey. I like to hear people's names pronounced correctly. So the next planning board meeting, I believe, is December 13th. And so I expect this to be calendared for that. And I think that the company should have some kind of notice that there's going to be a discussion at that time.
Did you say December 13th?
Yes. Yeah.
That's too late. This is at the state now.
That's the next meeting that we have for
the permit was put in. Well, that's why I'm asking you to notify the state, put the permit to the state on hold pending some additional investigation in terms of this, because
Dr. Ulickney, the people who own the property have rights as well, and if we were to just revoke a permit or to put a roadblock up in their way when they have complied with the ordinance, then the county would be subject to lawsuit by those people. So
you may be subject to that in terms of whether or not you actually conducted your fiduciary responsibility as a local government to address this and to this issue. So, you know, you can take it one way or the other. It's up to you. But
Well, can I ask that maybe Clyde, you or Brian are together, talk to the appropriate people at the state and see what can be done to...
Why don't we have a discussion?
We are well for that. I mean...
Commissioner Byrd, we can see what rights have vested since this person has owned the property, purchased the property, complied with our ordinance. I don't know where they are in the state process, but those are the facts that this board needs to know before they make any...
I think there's a good point made that maybe we didn't do our fiduciary responsibility in just overseeing the process and making sure that we had the right ordinances in place to protect the community.
Well, the ordinance is what it is. The board approved it and set it up that way.
Yeah, but it wasn't this board.
It's directly in violation, I think, with the North Carolina statute that requires the local board.
We have not adopted a certified development ordinance in this county.
But I'd like to suggest one other thing.
I agree. You know, I mean,
Dr. Ulickney, Commissioner Byrd is speaking.
Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry.
Well, I'm sorry.
You know, I'm emotional. We're all are.
I understand.
This is our property, and this
absolutely.
Is, you know.
I would be too. So we have two pillars in our strategic plan that impact this, and that is the preserving agriculture pillar and the smart growth and development pillar, and they both talk about land use planning,
right.
And we need to just put on the table for some community discussions about beefing up our land use planning, and that may end up being zoning. Maybe it's township zoning, maybe it's full countywide zoning. But I think this is a good time to launch that.
Well, let me do this. Let me get you some alternatives for the board to consider. How about that? And we'll see if we can gather what facts we can gather.
Yeah, on the state process.
And I'm sure they've got an attorney, and I'll talk to him, the quarry owner. So, and I'll put a report together for you.
That would be great. I think that would be appropriate.
Yeah. There's an awful lot at risk to not do something, everything that we can.
I still would like for the planning board to take a look at our heavy industrial ordinance and see, as a board, how we could proceed in future projects, because Alamance County is going to see more and more of these kind of situations come up. And, you know, this is, I regret what's happening to you all and to your community.
They clearly didn't look at the gas
line. Yeah. So we do regret that. But this is not come up in, you know, the public comment period is not really it's not a vehicle for transformation or decision at this point tonight. We're glad that you raised the point.
We had no choice. I mean, we just found out about this Wednesday when the permit, it was actually approved by the county on 9/25/2028.
Right. So we can... see what we can do.
Yeah, I mean,
no offense, I don't want any middle of the road questions and answers. Take it to the max, take it to the minimum, or in the middle as to what can be done. Max, minimum, or in the middle. Now, let me ask you a question,
yes,
if I may. Was there any belief that they would be hooked up with any asphalt companies with this business?
Not that we know of. It's been applied as a gravel pit mine. You know, one thing that, as a taxpayer, that, you know, if people come, let's say a bicyclist gets hit by these trucks going one way, my well goes dry, we have a catastrophic spill from the gas line that's on there, people are going to come back looking for restitution. Certainly they'll go to the company, but they're going to come to you. And I would much rather have my tax dollars be used to improve the infrastructure of our county than to pay legal fees.
See, the reason I ask that about asphalt was Chapel Hill several years ago.
Right.
They were trying to come up and build an asphalt plant here,
right,
in Alamance County, because Chapel Hill wouldn't allow it down there or whatever. How did we get out of that? And now I'm going to show my naivety, or whatever the word is. Is it asphalt gravel with tar?
It's made up of a lot of things.
And if that's the case, and you had Chapel Hill trying to come up here with an asphalt company, now you got this. I mean, you got 2/3 or 3/4 of the components of asphalt, I'm sorry, it just smells odd.
This is a 300-acre plus project.
I agree. Sorry, well, smell right.
I do agree with Commissioner Byrd that we have some land use challenges that are looming large for our county, and I'm deeply concerned about that myself. And we've got the super site in Randolph County just across the border. And as that comes, eventually, somebody's going to take advantage of that site. Didn't happen last year, but it's going to happen. And we want to do what we can to look forward and think about how do we preserve our county.
Well, we want the commissioners to represent us in Southern Alamance the same way you do, you know, Graham. This commission just recently unanimously voted to oppose a pipeline that was coming down into Graham. It just seems odd to me, and kind of in direct competition, that you would approve a project that is blasting near a jet fuel gas line.
Well, number one, we did not approve because it didn't have to come before.
That's what I'm saying. It was never approved.
Yeah.
But the buck stops with us.
I mean, right. Really, right. We do need to follow
all right
up on
this. I appreciate you listening, and I hope you understand that when something.
Dr. Elnicki, I'm sorry to interrupt, but it's 7:45.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
And we have an agenda to get
okay
through.
Thank
and
you again for your time.
I appreciate that very much. Right. So, speaking of our agenda, we have items. The next item on it is for approval of the agenda. If we could have
a motion, so moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for approval of the agenda. If everybody's had a chance to look it over, if there's any further discussion, hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, next is the consent agenda. If everybody's had a chance to review the consent agenda.
I'll make a motion that we approve as is.
I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. If there's no further discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Next, we have the approval to trade in surplus property with Brian Baker.
This was left over from our last meeting, I think, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right. Last time we had three things that had to be tabled, and this is
and here they are, one, two, three.
We wanted to make sure this was first tonight. Two quick items, commissioners. Approval to trade in surplus property. You guys approved a tractor for us in this year's budget. Apparently, according to my staff, I didn't ask for enough money. And we would like to trade in our existing tractor towards the acquisition of a new one. Not asking for any new money, just would be able to apply that towards the purchase of a new tractor.
Tractors are expensive, aren't they, sir?
Apparently.
But
yes,
they're worth every penny.
Yes.
Save a lot of time.
This one, the one, our existing tractor is an 84. We've gotten our use out of it, so it's time for a new one.
So one question I had, I noticed that the trade-in value you're getting for the old tractor is worth more than the market value
yeah
of it. So does that mean that if you didn't trade it in, you could get it that much discount from just a straight out purchase?
So if we don't trade it in, it goes on GovDeals, and it's a government auction site, and the rates are a little lower than you might get somewhere else. So we just kind of looked at these things were going for.
Well, I know, but what I'm saying is if they're willing to pay more than the market value of the truck on a trade-in, if you didn't trade it in, wouldn't they be willing to not charge the full retail price because the trade-in value is against the retail value, retail price of the new?
Yeah, trying to pin down a vehicle salesman is a difficult thing, but I do think that we got bids on the tractor alone and then the trade-in separate.
I think it's a good move what you're doing. I mean, you're coming out ahead, it looks like to me.
And we don't have to go through any bid process for this.
We did get bids on the trade-in and the tractor separately. Yeah, we've gone through that.
Are you trading with Garvin?
That's a good answer.
Out the company, who's he trading with?
I'm not sure that I know who won the bid on the tractor. I got the trade-in bids, but I don't know who won the bid on the tractor yet.
Kubota tractor, right?
Yeah. Graham tractor and new
Kubota. Put that in the packet. We got three bids. I'm sorry, I don't know who the winner is.
Oh, now how you gonna know where to take the tractor and trade it in?
It's written down. I just don't remember. I apologize. Be happy to send that to you.
Okay. So there's two it's Kubota dealers in town. There's a new one downtown, Lander, and then there's Graham tractors. So.
Our purchasing director's here also. I don't know if he remembers off the top of his head.
You want me?
Yes, ma'am. See if Randy remembers where the tractor is.
Randy, do you remember?
I'm sitting there, racking my brain. I'm thinking Graham.
Probably so. Okay.
I'm running down my office.
As long as you know where to take the old tractor to trade it in, you're good.
Mr. Lester, Lashley has made a motion that we approve it.
I second that.
And Mr. Boswell has seconded. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Sweet. Great. What about that naming policy?
The second item is a naming policy. We get, this is not a response to any particular request to name one of our facilities, but we do routinely get requests to name our facilities after various things, usually people, businesses, things like that. We've just never really had any guidance on how to handle those things. And they come in quite frequently, and we just felt like we needed to have a policy on the way these things are done and how we will consider them. We kind of just looked around at other jurisdictions and gathered the best parts of those ordinances and put this one together. Certainly happy to consider any changes to the particulars, but we needed a policy of some variety.
In your research, is it pretty common that the final decision doesn't come before the governing body? It's just handled in the Parks and Rec Department?
It usually is handled by the Recreation and Parks Commission, which
is... We can change it.
Yeah, we can certainly change that. It's just a matter of efficiency there, but...
Well, with the commission, I mean, that represents the public, so as long as there's public involved.
Yeah, I think I like the idea better. We should be the ones deciding. I'll make that motion.
Okay, so we want to amend the naming policy to, under process, the final naming decision rests with the Alamance County Board of Commissioners?
Yes.
Yeah. Second that.
So do we need to have a vote, a separate vote to amend the policy? Or can we, if we...
You can approve it as amended.
Yeah, really what I was asking is maybe the approval resting with the Parks and Recreation Commission, not the Board of Commissioners.
I think
I'm good either way.
Yeah, I think they need to bring it to final approval.
Yeah, they can make a recommendation for you guys to get final approval.
So that would read, the final naming decision rests with the Alamance County Board of Commissioners with input and guidance from the Recreation and Parks Commission.
Yes.
And
that one sentence has got to change.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to adopt the Alamance County Recreation and Parks Department naming policy as amended. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, Mr. Haygood.
Madam Chair, may I interject something here, please?
Yes, please.
I was just curious about the statement I made and do more research. Asphalt. Concrete pavement mixes are typically composed of 5% asphalt cement and 95% aggregates. Mm-hmm. Aggregates, we've heard that word tonight. In parentheses, stone, sand, and gravel. Hmm.
Okay.
Just want to get that on the record before 10 o'clock.
Thank you. Good point. Mr. Haygood, South Annex demolition.
Thank you, Chair Gailey. Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here to discuss with you tonight the South Annex County facility located at 6343 Snow Camp Road. The facility is 1,936 square feet and was constructed in 1976. The primary use for the past several years has been weekly library service. The library system offered internet access, book checkout. Folks could drop off their books there to be taken back to the main branches or pick up books once a week delivered to this site. The South Annex has been in poor shape for a number of years. It was graded a D building by Alamance County Facilities a couple of years ago, so it's been graded as one of our worst facilities. We're in the middle of our facility plan, and we went ahead and had Clark, Patterson, and Lee evaluate the building. You can see there's a copy of their memo in the packet. Their recommendation was to demolish the building rather than renovate it. Just a quick list of the building's needs. One of the major needs is to remove and replace the exterior siding. The building does require a new roof, gutters, and downspouts. The doors, windows, ceilings, insulation all need to be replaced, as does the HVAC system and the floor joists. The original estimate when we graded it as a D several years ago was $75,000 to repair this building. Talked with facility maintenance since. Due to the cost of repairs have increased, we're estimating anywhere to $135,000 to $150,000 to totally repair the building as it is. The building also suffered additional damage during Hurricane Florence, and we have had to close the building. We had water get into the building, under the building, flood out the HVAC units, so it is now closed to the public. The library has removed all their materials from the property. What we would foresee doing if we demolish this building is replace the library services in the Snow Camp community with the bookmobile and also with the mobile internet cafe that's on the road now. Work with the library staff to schedule both of these services to be back into the Snow Camp community. So my recommendation to you tonight is to demolish the South Annex. We have a quote in your packet from D.H. Griffin. They've proposed $14,600 to demolish the property. We had some discussions with a couple of the fire departments in the southern end of the county. They are interested in doing a training burn, which D.H. Griffin estimates would reduce the cost of demolishing the property by $4,000. So we estimate $10,600 to demolish. One thing to note, and Buddy makes this very clear to me, the building will have to be abated for any asbestos or mold or dangerous materials in the building. That could drive that price higher. We just don't know. $10,600 feels pretty good, but once you get in there and start abating, you start discovering it's something else, asbestos, that you didn't realize.
How much do they have to do if they burn it?
They're estimating $10,600 in cost, so it would...
I mean abatement, I mean...
They'll have to abate before they burn. Actually, I had that conversation with Johnny Payne, fire marshal, today. Before they can burn the building, we still have to abate it. So I guess there's a concern about getting the fire department in there or whatever they may release into the air.
That building's not that old.
That's true. Yeah. The county, so we did, the building did receive damage during Hurricane Florence. We believe we are going to receive up to $20,000 from our insurance company because the building was damaged. They do know that we're planning to demolish the building. So what I would request is that the board approve the demolishment of the building, that we can use the proceeds from the insurance settlement that we'll receive from the insurance company, which we believe will be up to $20,000. I can't give you a hard number, but we believe it will be up to $20,000. If the demo and the abatement costs more than the insurance monies that we believe we'll receive, I would request that we're able to tap into the funds that are designated for county facilities. That total dollar amount right now is $3,381,412. These are the peak sale monies that we've designated for county properties. I believe that the insurance money will pay for this, but in the event it doesn't, I'd like to go ahead and get approval from the board to get the balance from this designated fund. If the situation arises that the insurance money will pay for the demolishment and have some funds left over, I would ask that the board allow us to make some repairs to other county properties that suffered damage during Hurricane Florence with the remainder of the $20,000. So that's a little bit of a confusing deal. I'm asking you to allow us to demo the building, use the insurance money up. If we use up all the insurance, we'll tap the designated funds. If we don't use the insurance money for the South Annex, we'll turn around and use it on another county property. So.
What will we do with the land?
So the Clark Patterson Lee recommended that we talk with the surrounding property owners about acquiring the rest of the property. I don't believe we're in a place to do that at this point. What we'll probably do is just hold it. And once we get through our facility plan, I'd recommend that we hold it. Once that's over, if we haven't identified a use for the property, you could consider selling it or you could consider just sitting on it. I think it could be a spot for the mobile internet cafe or the bookmobile because we're going to leave the parking area. So it might be a nice spot. Folks are used to coming there for the library service now. The parking will remain. So we can make decisions about it. But without the building, our liability is greatly reduced. We're just mowing and picking up trash.
And it's on a slab, right?
I believe so. Yes.
Okay. You need a motion? I'll move that we do all that you listed.
Okay.
And get the fire department to burn it.
That's right, yes. Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, they need to practice.
Yes, indeed.
Right, Johnny?
Mr. Lashley has made a motion. Is there a second?
Yeah,
right here. Oh, you did? I'm sorry. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Mr. Hill. Now we'll talk about this franchise agreement. Actually, I guess it's we're considering an ordinance, correct? is the technical posture of the discussion tonight, is consideration of an ordinance.
So to get off on a very positive note, I just got an email from Duke Power. We're down to 276 people without power as of a few minutes ago. So knock on wood, they hope to be finished tonight. We're here tonight to talk about the review of the results of a request for proposal we sent out for our franchise agreements relating to garbage and recyclable collection and disposal. One of the basic questions is why? So a couple of things to keep in mind. We had not updated our franchise agreement since 2004. A lot of technology changes. We hear this from the two companies wanting to get to uniform can size using the new trucks and the arms and all that to make it as efficient as possible and keep the cost down. And to be honest with you, another reason for looking at this was the service issues relating to Republic. There were some comments made today, tonight, that I want to make sure we're clear on, and that Republic said that a lot of their issues were relating to the reroutes that they did, which I believe to be true. It's also true that there was enormous problems before those change of routes. So we were fielding a lot of telephone calls before they decided to change their routes, and that was in combination with the issues they were having in Guilford County. So a little bit later, if you guys want to respond to that as to how that came into play. So to remind you of our August meeting on kind of why we're doing this and some of the major points of improvement in our new agreement, the franchise will be exclusive for each area. You're not allowing people to come in and take market share. We tied the household garbage and recyclable programs together per area for one simple reason. Recycling. The recycle market is a flux. We've all talked about that. This county does not do an admirable job of promoting recyclables. I ran some numbers while we were waiting. I think these guys will back us up. Only about one-third of the people eligible for curbside service outside the municipalities are actually getting that service. Sound about right?
I'm sure about less than that.
Well, I'm showing 33.6% for Republic and 35.4% for Waste based on your database. And recyclable, only about a little less than 7% for Republic and about 8% for Waste Industries. I just tell you that to give you an idea that the overwhelming majority of people in the unincorporated areas are not taking advantage of it. Air, recycle, and solid waste programs request us to encourage recycling, to keep it out of the landfill. And every decision that we've made and every recommendation we will make has directly to do with that, keeping recyclable out. Okay, the new agreement is for a 5-year contract with a 3-year option. We added, at the vendor's request, a tie-in to a consumer price index. And that's to allow them to take advantage that when the consumer prices go up, they are able to flex their schedules so they don't result in loss over long periods of time. That's supported by both groups. We also included that if our tipping fees increase, they are able to adjust their prices by 10% of that tipping fee. I have been very vocal with this board that tipping fees will have to go up in the future because of our capital requirements. So as much as anything, we want to protect the consumer, but we also want to protect the vendor to make sure that they have the economics to make this a viable program. We also included that the garbage has to come to the landfill. You've heard us talk about some changes in state law. All of the recycled material must go to a MRF, local MRF, and the franchise must furnish to the county a performance bond in the minimum of $200,000, and they also must furnish workman's compensation and commercial liability. So those are just some major changes that we made on trying to improve the franchise agreement for everybody concerned. To remind everybody, you've heard a lot of Area 1, Area 2, and Area 3. Here's a color-coded map. If you guys need copies or if the media needs them,
I need a copy.
Sure.
So this historically how the county has been divvied up. So see area one, these approximate values of how many people and how many households are based on the most recent census data. So area one and area two, the pink and green, are now serviced by Republic. Area three that you see in blue, which the majority is the southern part of the county, south of the interstate, is now being serviced by Waste Industries. Any questions about that? After sending out the RFP, we got results. We sent this out to six companies. I'm going to put the other one on there. Four of which decided not to reply or to bid. That resulted in only two companies responding, that being Republic Services and Waste Industries. If you look at the top schedule, it shows the prices quoted by Republic and Waste Industries. Republic quoted $16.50 for Area 1 garbage pickup and $11 for Area 1 recycling. Repeated that for Zone 2 and repeated that again for Area 3. Waste Industries came in with a price of $18 for garbage and $7.95 for recycling. And they repeated those same numbers for Area 2 and Area 3. So that is the baseline information that we received for the two quotes. At the bottom, you'll see where I just added those up. Pretty simple. Republic at $27.50 per month, Waste Industries at $25.95. Those numbers are the combination of those two costs. They're not weighted in any way toward garbage or recycling. They're simply the combination. The idea being that you want to promote as many people to take advantage of the service, both recycling and for garbage pickup. Before we actually finished up with the RFP, Republic came to us and wanted to know if they could ask some addendums. Sure, we're looking at all options. We're here to help the public. So they came in with a pricing schedule that if they were to keep the two areas they presently have, where sections one and two, they would drop their price for garbage pickup from $16.50 down to $15.85. So that would result, again, in a combination price of $26.85 per month.
Do we not? We don't have that in our packet right here, do we?
Yeah, it should be this sheet right here. You should have this sheet. If not, I can get it to you.
I've got the initial, but I don't
see that. I'm sorry. That was a joke.
Thank you.
And I can't really see that screen, so you might give me a piece of paper.
So if you combine all three areas, Republic was willing to drop their price again from $16.50 to $15.85 down to $15 per month for the garbage pickup. That would result in a unified cost of $26 per month. So, to us, the question is, what's the best deal for the citizen? We looked at it very simply, that the lowest price indicated was the $25.95 that Waste Industries put up. Keep in mind, there's been a lot of conversation about price increases and all that. I think both companies did an exceptional job of keeping the prices down, given the market that we're in, especially on the recyclable side. The present cost that we're working under now is $16.50 and $5.95. So you'll see that those prices have gone up very little, if any. Matter of fact, Waste Industries price is actually cheaper when you take out the can rental price, and we ask that to be included this time. Everybody has uniform cans. So our recommendation to the board is simply go to Waste Industries across the board at $25.95, because that was the best cost for the combined services.
So
questions?
You said it, but so a little, maybe roughly a third of people who are eligible to use the garbage service use it.
That's right.
So
and only 7% that are eligible to use recycling use that.
That's correct, as best we can estimate.
So if you kept that, I mean, if you did weight it according to those ratios, overall it'd be better to have Republic's pricing. Did I get that backwards?
Well, you get down to, the cheapest price that Republic shows you, is the $15 and the $11. That's $26 per month. Okay? Now, their MSW is $15 compared to the $18 that Waste Industries is quoting there. So it would be cheaper.
But a lot of people aren't going to use recycling. Now, if everybody used this, that used garbage used recycling, that would be cheaper, but that's not the case.
But we also have guidance from this board to do everything we can to try to promote recycling.
So you'd like to get them even?
We would like it to be 100% for both.
Right.
Let me just interject that just because people don't use curbside recycling doesn't mean that they necessarily don't recycle.
Absolutely.
I would be an example of that myself because I am too cheap to pay the Republic service customer, and I am too cheap to pay the monthly pickup fee, so I pack it, you know, we throw it in the back of the truck and haul it over to the recycling center. So,
and we see continual growth in that process through our drop-off facilities. Those numbers continue to go up. Just a footnote in the whole scheme of things. If you look back a year or two ago, we were averaging about 275 tons of trash a day. We're now doing 425. Wow. There are days where we have approached 600. We're now going to exceed our permitting levels. We're going to have to go to the state and increase that. So that doesn't have anything to do with these programs other than to tell you the county is growing. We're producing more and more, whether it's construction debris or whether it's just general household trash. It's just a lot more coming at us. So what we're trying to do is promote recycling as much as possible in any way, shape, or form. We came to this board several months ago and asked you to give us an allowance to take 125 tons of cardstock, cardboard, because we were hearing they have no place to take it, and you were gracious to do that. Some of that seems to have worked itself out now. So it's a complex issue.
What's the variance in the recycling fees from the companies? I guess we need to ask both companies why one's cheaper than the other.
Well, let me give you a footnote, and then you guys can take it from there if you want to. So the closest MRF, I believe, is owned by Republic in Greensboro. Okay, now the odd thing, if you want to say odd, is their pricing for recycling is higher than Waste Industries, which has to pay Republic for the use of their facility. So this gets into their business models, which we're not here to try to understand why.
I'm just curious, it is a big difference.
Mr. Eisenhower, would you like to come up and make your case for your company and why?
May I ask Mr. Deaton?
Yes.
May I ask? Okay, I'm sorry. I'll probably get ruled out of order. Were you related to any Deatons that work for Burlington Industries?
No.
Okay, thank you.
You can leave me.
That saved me a lot of time, Madam Chair, and I appreciate that.
Saved us a lot of time, I guess, too.
Mr. Eisenhower, would you like to come up and explain your perspective,
Brother Bird?
Take
a pitch.
Sure. As far as the question about the rate differences in the recycling price, you know, we model every municipal bid and apply the appropriate margin that we want to make off of it. And recycling, as I mentioned when I met with the two commissioners 4 months ago, the China sword situation that happened where China cut off all U.S. recyclables imported into China. So we had to go where we were getting $120 a ton for cardboard going into China. The markets dropped out the bottom of it. We were paying to ship mixed paper to India and paying as high as $40 a ton where we were making $120 a ton. So we had $160 a ton swing on the market whenever that happened. The market's come back a little bit. Now we're getting about $10-$20 a ton on mixed paper overseas. So we're trying to find more domestic markets to open up that'll buy the material. So that's what happened. We had a $160 a ton swing a year ago in the recycling market. So our costs to run our facility over here are around $85 per ton that we run through that system. You know, you're looking at about a $25 million investment in the equipment over there. The equipment is outdated. We're having to upgrade it. So what we've done is, since we acquired that recycling facility in October a year ago, is we're making investments to upgrade it. And Waste Industries does dump the materials there, but our price had in there for the upgrades on the capital investment in the equipment and what the current market conditions are, and we see those to be going forward. So our price is secure irregardless. And as I mentioned to you, I can guarantee you that whatever happens, you know, our facility is not going to shut down. If it does for equipment repairs, I'm not going to change prices or anything. I'm going to ship it to another one of our facilities. So, you know, that's really for the difference in the pricing. And as far as the, you know, the rates, again, we use weighted averages in our analysis, because the reality is you're not going to get your current, it's good thinking and a good goal to have to increase recycling participation to preserve the life of your landfill. But, you know, if you doubled the participation, it's currently at 21-22%, I believe, for both companies. So if you doubled the participation to 42%, we're still low bid, even if you double the participation, because of the $15 per ton trash rate that we proposed, and versus the current at $16.50 and the competitor proposed at $18.
Let me interrupt you for a second.
Sure.
I thought, Mr. Hill, what did you say the recycle participation rate is that you had? Wasn't it 30-some percent?
Yeah, if you take a look at the amount of people that are, go off the map, where you should estimate the amount of households, and then you look at how many clients are servicing, that's the ratio.
So you would say, though, it's 21%?
Yes.
So there's a...
Well, participation rates and set-out rates are two different things in our industry, and our competitor can probably acknowledge that. So what we're talking about is 21% is the current participation rate, not a set-out rate. So that based on the materials that we're actually picking up at each household.
In other words, you're picking up 21% of containers.
Correct.
And putting them in your recycling
Correct.
Truck.
We're both 21-22%.
Yes.
Of the ones that we service.
Correct.
Richard was saying there was 33% of trash for everybody that lives
right.
in that area, 7% of recycle for everybody, not necessarily everybody that has trash.
Right. Because everybody doesn't have trash pickup in the county. Mm-hmm. Some people haul it to their work or
yeah.
somewhere else, so we don't service all the residences mm-hmm. in the county.
They're cheaper than I. So, can you explain this chart that was handed up during the public comments?
Yes. Basically, that takes our proposal and it puts in the weighted average based on the actual recycling, current recycling participation rate, and breaks it down on all three areas, or if we continue to service area one and two, or you know, the individual areas that we submitted bids on.
What regional landfill do you use?
We use your landfill under the franchise agreement.
Totally?
Yes. It's required under the agreement. Yeah.
You won't be looking at Randolph County or
no, sir.
Any other land?
No, I mean, we have franchise agreements with other municipalities, and you know, we have the same type of arrangements where we have to dispose of it in Catawba County's example of that, where we have a franchise agreement and they require us to dump in their landfill, even though I've got one just in the next door county in Alexander County. So.
I guess really my thoughts on this whole process, had we not had all the complaints of service, we probably wouldn't be here tonight discussing.
I agree.
This is a totality type thing.
I agree. I apologize for that. There's no excuse. I'm not going to sit here and make any.
So. Took a lot of my time answering emails and stuff.
Amen.
Yeah, when I met with the commissioners 4 months ago, I actually got a complaint that day on the email, and I actually went out and picked it up in my own pickup truck and brought it back.
So. And I heard from that customer. They were very appreciative.
Yeah, I've spoke with them a couple times since, and fine folks.
So if I summed it up saying that for the current customers, Republic has a lower cost in the new proposal, but y'all have had some complaints in the last year, questions about the reliability of the service, and then we have the factor that we want to encourage people to recycle. So we hope that as time goes on, the number of recycling, curbside recycling customers will increase and not stay at 21%. Does that kind of sum up the problem?
Well, it has to go to 90% participation before the bids will be closed. Mm-hmm. And I'm a realist.
Well, that's true, but you're a very intelligent man, but you also know that what product doesn't go to recycling goes to the trash for either company. Mm-hmm. That trash comes to us, and there's nothing you will do that's more expensive than the airspace at a landfill.
Oh, I agree. So $350,000 an acre.
Keep that in mind, that the years, and this has nothing to do with you guys, the years of telling you that the life of the landfill continues to increase are over. Our volumes are peaking and they continue to go up. And we've got to try to do everything we can to try to keep anything out of that landfill that we can.
I'd mention too that the based on us having the recycling facility, again, I've done this a long time, we offer to our customers, municipal customers, free public education and tours from civic group schools at our recycling facility. And again, it's on the east side of the county, so you know, as the crow flies, it's probably 15 miles from here, so right off the interstate. But we offer that to all our municipal customers. We have an education center there, and my experience is you can get your participation up some through the school groups, because the children will come to the facility, get educated on it, and they'll go home and get their parents to recycle, is the mentality behind that, if you will. That's what we do in Mecklenburg County at our facility that we run.
I think that's a lot of truth in that.
Yeah, I think so. It works.
Mr. Hill, what the comment you just made about the life of the landfill and getting the air out, how does that impact one vendor over the other?
Well, again, for every piece of product, regardless of who's picking it up or not picking it up, that gets put in the trash. And that trash, by definition, comes to our landfill, whether it's a franchise agreement or whether it's the city of Burlington running their own independent fleet. It comes to us. So the estimate right now, the next 15 acres you've asked us to look at, is approximately $5 million just to build that 15-acre site. About $325,000 an acre to site it and build it. That's enormously expensive. Plus the millions of dollars that we're spending on capital, the equipment, the compactors, the shredders, all the other things that go with it. So the most expensive thing we can possibly do is take up air volume in the landfill. Just the most expensive. So anything that we can do to reduce that goes back to our idea of recycle as much as you can, get it out of the landfill, promotes environmental stewardship, but it also decreases how often we have to go back and ask for more money to build more landfill. That's uniformly across the country.
Right.
It's a complex issue.
It is. And it'd be kind of nice if we could just say, let's leave, just move on as we've been going, you know, and split it. But I know they bid it out, considering the whole county, I guess.
Well, I think we could say Area 1 and Area 2 still go with Republic, and Area 3 still goes with the Waste Industries. I think we could have the ability to do that, right?
Waste Industries.
You certainly have that option. Be aware that you're going to have part of the county paying one rate and part of the county paying another.
They're already doing that, though, right?
Well, the prices are uniform right now, other than Republic does not charge for can rental, and Waste Industry charges $2. But the base price for both is all the same.
I'd like to make a comment, if I could, about our pricing, if that's okay.
Yeah, sure.
I was going to ask you to do that.
So. Anyway. I'm not very patient, I'm sorry. Well, our pricing of $18, if you remember me saying that we're going to purchase all brand new trucks. So we're not going to take a chance on the next 5 years having to use antiquated equipment or equipment that's worn down. Brand new carts, that's a lot of capital investment on our part. as far as the, that, and that's what really fed out the $18. We took all the addresses that we had, we took all the addresses that Republic provided. We did a, we had our GIS department put it in a map and see how long it would take us to pick it all up, and we've calculated into that. So we didn't, you know, we didn't feel like we needed to spare the expense of trying to run old equipment. You know, you wanted supreme service, what you expect, that's what we want to provide. As far as our recycle price, we do take a lot of material to ReCommunity that Republic owns, but that's not our only option. We have contracts with the other two major recyclers here in North Carolina, Pratt, Sunoco. We have options, you know, that's, we're never limited to one person. Recycling and hauling is our moving is a lot different than trash. You can dump recyclables on a concrete without a permit. It's a lot easier to move recyclables everywhere else. I'm not saying I don't take stuff to ReCommunity, but we do. But we do have options, and we actually calculated our price per lift, and the $7.95 was a good price for us, based on the requirements that we were given. So the $18 I'm trying to explain is all the capital we're going to have to expend to provide the new equipment. So, thank you. Anybody have any questions?
How does this affect the municipalities' use of various companies?
Okay, so the municipalities in the county all run their own fleets, garbage, and they bring it to us. All the municipalities hire,
we do a couple of the smaller.
Burlington, Graham, Mevin all bring their trash to us by their own fleets. They pay a tipping fee just like everybody else does. All the recycling in those major municipalities is handled by Waste Industries. Waste Industries then has the responsibility of transporting all of that product to either ReCommunity in Greensboro or alternate MRFs for the recycling.
How long is the contract for?
Five years. With a 3-year option.
So I do believe we put language in the ordinance in the event we become dissatisfied with a provider too. We have a course of action to take. So if we choose one of the vendors, or you go with both the vendors in the different areas, we do have a way to handle any problems that we expect.
Sure, go ahead.
I just wanted to clarify a few things and bring it to the attention of the commissioners that recycling has gone up regardless. It's going from $5.95 to $7.95. So the likelihood that participation will increase is not likely. If people are not going to pay $5.95 now, they'll be less likely to pay $7.95. And so the recycling was going up uniform for both companies, correct? So I wanted to make sure that everybody understood that. We knew that the price of recycling would have to increase just because of the industry, the way that it is right now. And so we put our efforts in making and maximizing the benefit to the residents in Alamance County to have a lower rate, and also for suffering through our growing pains for the last year. And then I also want to speak to my role with Republic and something that's happened in another county that I work with in another state. And this is just to be mindful. If you choose to go with one vendor for all three, you reduce the competition. And therefore, if you start having failure, who do you have to back up or to step in if one of them fail? There's also some methods that you can add to the contract with liquidated damages also to make sure that it ensures service. Again, if you go with one vendor, you lose your leverage to be able to have another vendor to come in. And you only had two companies respond to the RFP. That's another thing I want to, shed a little light on. Republic feels that we presented the lowest responsible bid. We've been here for 22 years, and we also feel that there wasn't, the integrity of the bid process wasn't really transparent as far as the weighting and putting that, and combining the trash with the recycling as one rate, and making two-thirds of your county get an automatic price increase.
Well, we've addressed that by talking about it, so.
But that is true.
And I think that that's all that I had left to say.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Can I have a minute with the board?
Big part?
Okay, can I have a minute with the board?
Sure. Unless somebody wants to make a motion.
Lynn's waiting on that.
Good evening.
My name is Travis Hitchcock. I'm the Regional Vice President for Waste Industries, and there's three things I really wanted to get across to the board. Was in our response, we took to consideration three things, and I think they're the most important things for the county. The first being that you guys have an interest in increasing your recycling due to some of the constraints that exist in the landfill. That's part of why we have the premium rate on the recycling. Additionally, we heard a lot about service, and we built our model and proposal based off the fact that we needed to acquire new equipment to ensure that we actually deliver on some of the biggest concerns of the county. And that's what we're committing to you all, is that we're going to purchase all new trucks and containers to supply, you know, your residents. Lastly, we are partners and we are contributing to your county on a regular basis. We employ 28 individuals here. We have an office that's based in your county as required by your ordinance. Our competitors do not. So there are things that we're trying to improve. Okay. So that's what we're here to address and share with you, that we are partners of your community and we want to continue to do that through this franchise agreement.
Thank
Anyone
you.
Anyone have any questions?
There is a disagreement, though. You, both companies do have a presence here in the county.
It's required by the ordinance. So, yes, we do. We have an office here.
Okay.
I want to clarify, because I'm off, full disclosure, my mother told me to tell the truth. We have an unmanned office here.
Unmanned.
Correct.
So that nobody speaks on our behalf.
Okay.
So it's a tough decision.
It is.
And with all due respect to Republic, I'm tempted to take the recommendation of our staff.
But a lot of the folks are getting an increase on their garbage will be in my neighborhood, so I've got to consider that, because this is one picking up my side of town.
Yeah, I live in Area 1, and
yeah.
I do want to acknowledge, yeah, we had a lot of trouble over the winter, last winter, but I do feel like things have gotten a lot better, and that we did, you know, go the distance in trying to get things worked out.
Thank you. In that respect, I told you earlier today, whatever decision the board made, take it on the chin and move on.
Well, I appreciate the efforts that you made to make things right.
I mean, I feel like for the people who live in Area 3 in the southern part of the county, I would hate, I mean, they're pretty, I guess they're happy with what they have.
I guess.
I mean, why mess with what?
North of paying less.
Working for them, why mess with what they have and they like it?
Yeah.
You know, but then for Area 1 and 2, it's hard because, you know, you don't want to give them a price increase, that's for sure. But if they were unhappy with the service, then
I think having a competitive edge by having the two companies work, it may still work. It has for how many years?
I agree with you.
Well, that's, yeah,
good,
that
was a good point.
Yeah, I think that's a good point.
I'm sorry?
Having a competitive edge by having both companies working in the
Well, my vibes are, I'm going to give you vibes.
Let's hear it.
Body language, vibes. I don't want to cut Republic totally off.
I don't either.
Yeah.
I will make a motion then, if you would like a motion, that we leave the areas as they are.
I'll second that, Eddie.
Both service the areas that they're in.
So, by definition, that means that you would stay with Republic in areas 1 and 2,
yep.
And stay with Waste Industries in area number 3.
And I want to know which one of them gets behind Come Park Plaza at 3 o'clock in the morning and takes those big boxes and just bangs them like crazy.
That's probably the city.
Who's doing it?
City of Burlington, probably.
Huh?
City of Burlington.
I swear it sounds like a bomb going off. I'm not lying.
Boom, boom.
Yeah.
Yeah, but not 3 in the morning.
And I think it is worth noting that Republic has cut their price since they came in with the original bid, right?
Right.
In response
was that contingent
to the concerns.
On for the whole area, though?
I don't know.
They
was
had
it?
The option of area 1 and 2 on that handout I gave you.
Right. Right.
So that was the $26.85 per month cost. I'm assuming that's the one that you would want to go with.
Right.
So is that correct? We're approving the alternative proposal from the public?
Alternate one.
Mm-hmm. Alternate one.
26.
Areas 1 and 2.
Yes.
That's the price.
That's correct.
You got a motion and a second.
And we also got a understanding that if they do what they've done before, we're going to replace them.
Correct.
Okay. Won't. Yeah.
But we need that in that. And the.
A lot of safeguards.
Yeah.
That was a big part of that
right.
process.
Yeah.
I'm okay with that.
All right.
Okay. Good. So we do have a motion and a second for alternative one, having Republic Services in areas 1 and 2, and Waste Industries continue to service area 3. Is that right?
Yes, that's the motion.
See it.
So is there any more discussion on that? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Uh-huh.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Sir.
May I possibly get out of line again, but I think it's important to say it now, not in customer commission comments, please.
Sure.
I don't know why I have to do this stuff up here. This is why I'm saying we had an inept decision at planning. I Googled, now if I'm wrong, somebody tell me. I Googled the guy's name who signed the whatever letter or whatever.
The LLC.
Right.
President or whatever. Manager.
And it comes up that he is plant manager of an asphalt paving company in Monroe. Now, I sit up here, and you can smell asphalt from A to Z.
We had an ordinance just for that.
Yeah.
And I'm just
so we can go back to that.
I'm flabbergasted that David, this stuff comes up.
David Smith, the organization, set that up.
Yeah. We didn't do our homework. This guy is plant manager of an asphalt, Boggs Paving. And if you Google Boggs Paving, the owners of that company went to prison for fraud. And why and I don't mind doing it. I love doing it. That's why I was about to explode up here. I don't want to wait 9 o'clock to tell that.
Right.
But by George, somebody didn't do the homework. And I don't think that person's with us anymore. That's grounds alone for some serious questions. But Google it. Boggs Paving, Monroe. And his name on this is Chad. All I had to do was input Chad Threat. Is that not his name?
I have no idea.
Says he's vice president of Alamance Aggregates. Chadthreatt. I just Google that. And it pops right up. Plant manager of Boggs Paving, Monroe, North Carolina. And that the owners of that company went to prison for fraud.
Mr. Sutton, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I'm kind of slow sometimes.
No.
I miss the point. So you're saying that you have concerns that Alamance Aggregate is not really a quarry, that it's really an asphalt company?
No, it's a quarry, but it's going to be a tool for asphalt. See, we had an asphalt company trying to come up here from
That's
Chapel Hill.
Yeah,
and we stopped it.
We got an ordinance
and,
on the
and I'm telling you, if there's not a link
it's the
there,
the same ordinance. This heavy industrial development ordinance governs how an asphalt plant would be sited in Alamance County too. So there are four classes of
industry that this ordinance covers, and asphalt is one of them. So the same public notification, the same process would apply if an asphalt company came today to want to apply for a permit. It would run through the same ordinance. So
yeah,
it is concerning that, you know, that there's not a level of notification, but the ordinance doesn't
matter. That's not the point. Point is ethics, morality, motivations, and so forth and so on. And for one person to have control of that scenario with that, I guarantee you, the planner didn't even know it.
Sure.
But a little lowly paid commissioner, which I don't do it for the money, can sit right up here in just a matter of minutes and discover it. It burns me up. Now, if I'm wrong, I swear I'll get on my knees and apologize. But I don't believe I'm wrong. Boggs paving, Monroe.
So you think this may be a front?
Oh, I don't think there's any question that it's a link.
All right, well, let's
what's he going to do with all that gravel on 300 some acres? He surely ain't going to pay put it in driveways, put it on the roads. But I'm sorry, you know, we got to have better expertise on what we're doing.
Let's move on with our agenda if you don't mind.
I ain't backing off anything I've said. I know that.
Well, we know that. So, Mr. Albright, what about these fees for public record copies?
Okay. We are being inundated with public records requests. And I have the Times News right here. How dramatic is that? No, we have gotten several. Watch this gentleman. Which I sent out to the board to get your emails. But the time has come now, because of the way we keep records now, with the computers and all the data that's in there. Especially at the sheriff's office, we've had to rely on Sergeant Dockery to retrieve these things. And some of these requests are quite complex. Got another one today. So there is the reason for this. I talked to a counterpart in Durham. Mm-hmm. They have a fee schedule, which I largely used here, and checked with our own folks about how much paper cost and copier cost and color copies cost. But the biggest problem is the hours that it takes to put these things together. And so that's addressed in this as well, if the board should choose to adopt this. But that's my recommendation, since it doesn't look like this is going to slow down any.
So we don't have anything now in place?
We have nothing now, other than we can charge you per page rate. But that was done 25 years ago, and we didn't have all this data that's collected. A lot of folks, if you've got it in a form that you can put on a CD, that's a lot better than copying, you know, 6,000 pages. The last massive request we got was from the ACLU right before the DOJ lawsuit, and they were in my office for a day copying stop reports, 6,600 some stop reports that we had to retrieve.
What's that per page rate now?
It's 10 cents. What was 10 cents per page back then? I don't think we've increased it.
No, it says 10 cents for 8.5 by 11 here.
Right.
And this compares with other counties?
With Durham. And they have some good things in here about digital documents and standard copies. A lot of people want copies of plat maps. Pretty expensive to get a big copy of a plat map, those type of things. So I think it's timely. If the board wants to consider doing this, now's the time. It'd be a good time to do it. And I'm not going to charge Burlington Time News any for those copies I made there. So, since we don't have since this was on the agenda tonight, I thought we'd discuss it and see which way the board wants to go.
I would say we'll take your advice.
No, thank you.
We'll make a motion.
I'll make a motion. We take your advice and charge, especially the AFL-CIO and that crowd. They still use double their prices.
Well, thank goodness I haven't heard from the AFL-CIO.
I think it's important that we have a pricing structure that doesn't inhibit transparency of our local government.
Right.
As long as this is comparable to other municipalities, right, and governments.
And the manager under this resolution has the authority to waive any fees when the fees would be too small to be worth processing, those type of things.
I will second Bill's motion.
Thank you.
Great. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. Social services budget amendment.
Good evening. I'm going to be brief. Before you, you have several budget amendments from social services. They include increased revenue and expenses. These are state and federal allocations. The only difference that includes any county dollars is $1,972 that's a required match for services for the blind. We are required by general statute to match their funding, and their funding increased a little bit prior to last year, since last year. And so we didn't budget the full amount, so we need an additional allocation from the general fund of $1,972. The rest of these are all additional funds to support our child care assistance administration, because we got more child care money and SIP and LEAP funding.
What are those services for the blind?
So we have on staff in our building a full-time social worker that serves folks that are that sight impaired, mm-hmm. and case management, eyeglass program, all of those things.
So this expands that a little bit?
This just covers the cost of that. It's divided up by counties. And we added a service dog this year. So she has a service dog. So the cost increased a little bit.
Well, I move approval.
I'll second that.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. We have a motion and a second for approval. Is there any more discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Saw a Guilford College girl today over in Greensboro. She's graduating. I said, what are you going to do when you get out? She said she wants to do social work. I gave her your name.
Great. Thank you.
Well, good. Mr. Hager, do you have a county manager report?
I'd just like to take this opportunity to say thank you to all the emergency service folks that worked very hard over time with Hurricane Michael. A lot of fire departments, police departments out on the road cutting trees. Emergency management did a great job. Also like to recognize Richard Hill and Clyde Albright for their work on those franchise fees. We haven't done that in a very long time. They did an excellent job. Process worked exactly like it should. Brought these vendors in here, especially ones that we've had some issues with. I think it got their attention and brought them, and that's all in the best interest of the citizens. So thank you, Clyde and Richard. It's a difficult process.
And Emily.
Emily, yes, indeed, Emily.
Emily is running out the door.
That's all I have.
Okay. Do we have any commissioners' comments anymore?
I'm just going to follow up a little bit on what Tim said. It seems like this process is broken on approving something as big as a quarry in our county, and I don't understand how that just gets by everybody, basically. I don't understand it. And
yeah, I agree.
I think that if you don't, I can maybe just speak a little.
Help.
I think the current level of approval per the ordinance is the planning director. You would hope, and I've talked with Tanya. I want Tanya to let me know if we have these come in. So as soon as they come in, I'm aware of it. I'm able to at least let the board know we've had, because this ordinance governs racetracks, asphalt plants, lots of things that we obviously are concerned about because we have an ordinance that addresses them. So, while right now we're going to continue to operate under the existing ordinance, at the least I would tell you, my discussions with Tanya have been to let me know as soon as the permit is applied for, so we can at least start a discussion, county attorney's office and with the commissioners, to let people know this has happened. Because it is something that makes you pause to think, a staff person at, department head level, or even frankly the county manager level could just sign off
on it. And I don't understand that.
Maybe if we put a chronology together, the ordinance has been amended since.
Oh yeah, definitely does. Mm-hmm.
It's been amended, I think, twice.
Right.
Once
things have been approved by the planning department first, and then to us.
And
in my opinion,
it's time to look at it again.
But even so, the way the ordinance is written, we don't have too much authority to deny anything as long as it meets.
Yeah, the staff did what the ordinance told them to do.
And if that's it, we need to look at that.
We need to look at that, yeah.
That's why I think that's appropriate for the planning board to take a look at that, though, because I think that.
Tanya, you're going to be on a new mission now, right?
You know, we had that whirly gig, wasn't it?
Whirly gig, yeah. The citizens brought that to our attention. This one's like it's already approved and gone to the state, and we hear about it from the citizen. It doesn't add up.
One thing I personally wanted to mention is I feel bad with Mr. Deaton leaving, Charlie Deaton. He came and gave his, you know, his public comment and kind of got overlooked by all the stuff about the quarry, and he raised some interesting points about the neighbors and how a person's use of their property impacts others. You know, 40 years ago, 25 years ago, when the county was less densely populated, I mean, I'm sure people still got on each other's nerves then, but not quite as much as now. But this is an issue, and it's going to continue to be a growing issue. One of the things that he mentioned was zoning, and we've already talked about zoning. I just wanted to mention that zoning has to do with use of a property as far as commercial, residential, industrial. It doesn't have to do with how much the grass grows
or whatever, yeah.
Or junk cars. We do have junk cars ordinances. Maybe we can look at those, but one person's junk car is another person's treasured
That's
antique.
That's true. That is so true. Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to say in my comment time that I appreciate Mr. Deaton taking the time to come forward, and I'm sorry that he left and didn't maybe get the attention that his issue deserved. So is anybody else got anything to say? All right. Well, if not, then we've done all our work, so we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.